In the last episode of America is Egypt, I presented the question, who built the pyramids? Was it slaves or Egyptians, like many of the scholars declare, built over decades of forced human labor? Was it the Anunnaki, the Aeneid, or maybe it was the ancient aliens? According to Herodotus, the father of Greek history, he was told it took over 20 years and 100,000 men to build the Great Pyramid at Giza. Did you know that accredited Egyptologists of the highest institutions consider Herodotus a legitimate historical resource? Now I know what you're thinking. Who the fuck is Herodotus? And even if you actually know who Herodotus is, you're thinking, how the fuck, and possibly, why the fuck would Herodotus be damn near the only person throughout history to document the construction of the pyramids in over 4,000 years? But it gets better. Herodotus lived a mere 2,000 years after the construction of the pyramids. At this point, it's understandable if you'd want to contact Sway and ask him how.
How, Sway?
Because ain't no way, boy. Ain't no way, boy.
Boy, ain't no way, boy. Boy, ain't no way, boy. Boy, ain't no way, boy. Boy, ain't no fuck.
When we turn our attention to chronology, too many questions arise about how could anyone build these pyramids given our accepted knowledge of human technology of the past? The so-called experts of Egyptian history propose everything possible inside the Stone Age box of hypotheses. However, if something can't be explained within their doctrines of acceptance, it is immediately tagged by the greater institutions and scribes of academia as pseudo. Yet one could simply ask the question, how solid is their foundation of evidence? To let them tell it, they are the gospel when it comes to ancient Egyptian history. And to that I say, she.
We ain't make those anchors, we ain't plot those gray sites. Up since daylight, burdened by the things we try to make right. It's gonna be a late night, so much turmoil makes my blood boil. Kundalini, encore, earth is unbroiled, dirt is unsore. With one core, tell a story that some spoil. Watch it unfold, stories untold, copyright unsold. Books with one spine, ghosts with one soul. They want control, you want control, but we share one goal. Fight one foe, satchel front door, and it keeps knocking, but the people kept rocking, yeah. And it keeps knocking, but the people kept rocking, yeah. Can't stop, flex, whatever they do. They can't stop, keep knocking, keep rocking, yeah, yeah. They can't stop us, no, no, nah. They can't stop us, no, no. They can't stop us.
For all that profile, shit. Yeah, partner, you should be paying me a fee.
Boy, ain't no way, boy. Boy, ain't no way, boy.
The who, what, when, where, and why are the most readily answered questions when it comes to the construction of the pyramids. But the how question is not so simple.
How, Sway?
Who? The Egyptians are the people most presumed by the scholars, although opinions vary on the type of Egyptian who was actually used in the construction? Were they slaves as proposed by the frontline Fugues, or were they skilled laborers as proposed by the scout team Tartif? Or were they aliens, Anunnaki gods as proposed by the New Age left? What were they? Pyramids. When? 4,700 years ago. There are a growing number of people who believe the pyramids are over 100,000 years old and possibly even older. Where? Egypt. A wonder of the world long abandoned and forgotten for nearly 2,000 years without so much as a book written about them throughout the recent history of time. That is, of course, until the French started writing books in the 1800s. And no, Herodotus, Diodorus, or even Josephus quotes do not count as books. Why were they built? Royal tombs constructed for pharaohs is the most common answer given as to why. Egyptologists are nearly in universal agreement in this assertion, and often cite evidence relating to the discovery of sarcophagi and supposedly royal mummies beneath its foundation for this reasoning. Although skeptics push back and say no actual mummies were found within the Great Pyramid. Within this pocket, there is a growing crowd of people who believe alternative theories for the pyramid's construction, including them being ley line energy vortexes or even satellite communication devices used to contact the Anunnaki aliens. How were they built? With chisels and rocks. This is what they want us to believe. They made this by doing this. And if you believe this, you must be smoking this. The first problem with the first question of who is the Egyptian is whose definition of an Egyptian are we using? Black's Law Dictionary's definition of an Egyptian? The historian's depiction of an Egyptian? The modern depiction of an Egyptian? The ancient genome of buried Egyptian corpses? Or something else? All of these definitions would describe different Egyptians. As quoted by Henry James Breasted in Season 1, Episode 4.
In 1905, Breasted wrote that studying early burials in Egypt had, quote, produced such a diversity of opinion among physical anthropologists as to render it impossible for the historian to obtain decisive results from their researches, end quote. In 1916, in Ancient Times, he sensibly described modern peasants in the Delta as both brown and as descendants of ancient Egyptians. The brown label sidestepped the insistence of many white Americans that except for American Indians and East Asians, you had to be either black or white.
The fascination around the pyramids have birthed many myths. The Hebrew myth has become popular recently. The theory that the ancient Hebrews built the pyramids during Joseph's time in Egypt. In general, most historians don't give this theory much credence because solid evidence of either cannot be historically or physically substantiated. In fact, unto this day, scholars say there is no evidence that Hebrews even lived in Egypt, even though Egypt and Israel are supposedly neighbors. That's like saying no Mexicans are in Texas. Unless Hebrews never lived in Never mind. Forget I said it.
You anti-dentite bastard.
The American Journal of Anthropology, in further studies of crania from ancient North Africa and analysis of crania from the first dynasty Egyptian tombs using multiple discriminant functions, determined crania analyzed from royal tombs to be more consistent with Kushites to the south in neighboring Sudan, noting a relatively significant sub-Saharan genetic marker. Should a first dynasty Egyptian be considered more Egyptian than, say, a 10th dynasty Egyptian? Should a 10th dynasty Egyptian be considered more Egyptian than a 20th dynasty Egyptian? The early Egyptians were Cushites, biblically sons of Ham under the lineage of Cush, not Mitzrayim, for whom biblically ancient Egypt was named. Most of the scholars put the construction of the Sphinx and the Great Pyramid in the 4th dynasty, circa 2600 BC, approximately 4600 years ago, which is actually over 1,000 years before the Exodus, according to their accepted chronology. But from the standpoint of considering anyone else's involvement, the general accepted premise of a pyramid builder would be a 4th dynasty Egyptian. However, was this Egyptian a slave or an artisan? Although it was attested for a time and still commonly believed that Egyptian slaves built the pyramids, now that idea is no longer in vogue charlatan doctrine. Instead, it is presumed that encampments for the builders were built alongside the pyramids, where they say evidence still remains, in the form of villages beside the pyramid complex. The question of what was or is an ancient Egyptian is honestly far more convoluted than simply asking the question, who built the pyramids? But the question of who is a true Egyptian has a minimum of several answers. The definition of an Egyptian largely relates to habitable location as opposed to ancestry and bloodline. This isn't a question of genetics, but rather nationality. It's like asking the question of who is a true American. Never mind. Although there are multiple pyramids to consider, the question of who built the Great Pyramid still remains. The narrative endorsed by accredited Egyptologists states they were built with the only available Stone Age technology of the time, meaning extraordinary measures were taken in order to construct this complex during an era of time when the wheel was not even used in Egypt, which leads us to the question of when. It's important to note, according to scientists, the Stone Age lasted from 3.4 million years ago to 3000 BC. This essentially means there was no significant human advancement in terms of technology in use for over 3 million years until the Bronze Age, which is marked by the introduction of metalworking and smelting copper into tools with more precision. After the Bronze Age, the Iron Age, marked by the advancement from soft metals like copper and into more solid and less malleable metals like iron, which would of course change human history with new weapons of war. All of this falls under the 3H system of dating, one of the earliest creations of archaeological methodology used by academics in the early 19th century. This methodology was eventually abandoned in lieu of new techniques such as radiocarbon dating. Be all this as it may, these classifications were quite vague considering the extreme length of 3 million years to describe Stone Age archaeology, during a time which, according to experts, Homo erectus evolved into the so-called modern human. Yet, the evolution of metalworking into modern technology happens in literally the blink of an eye. In comparison, speaking of comparison, according to those people, the wheel was invented in Mesopotamia around 4000 BC, but Egypt doesn't start using the wheel until over 3,000 years later. These places are only separated by less than 1,000 miles. So why did it take Egypt so long to get the will, especially considering they were trade partners during the same damn time? But suspiciously, they both seem to come into the respective ages of stone and iron at the same damn time. The will must have been a dirty little secret the Mesopotamians held over the Egyptians, just like the pyramids must have been a secret the Egyptians kept from the Mesopotamians. But of all the questions about ancient Egypt and their pyramids and complexes and works of art, the question most asked is how? How did they create these grandiose monuments? And even more so, how did they fabricate hardened stone into perfection? When it comes to explaining how these monuments are made, no less than 1,000,000 questions come to mind. But for the purposes of time, we're going to limit that number of 1,000,000 to just a few of the most pertinent questions. How were they able to lift 20 to 70 ton stones into perfect place with perfect precision? How did they cut these stones when the only tools at their disposal were rocks and copper chisels? How did they transport 70-ton granite slabs on boats down the Nile? Of all the questions, these three seem to be the most difficult for Egyptologists to give a clear answer to. From just these three questions, many theories were born. Of those theories, we examine the most popular to explain these questions.
Back with some history, and we're back with some history, yeah.
And we are back with another scour upon Charlatan's Web. So I think it's important that we have a working understanding of the history of Egypt in terms of who was there, for how long, and what were they doing while they were there? With all this being said, let's just turn our attention to the Crusades. So, specifically during the Crusades, I want to highlight Egypt, all right? So, we're just going to go to the most used place on Charlatan's Web, and this will be a fun trip. An enlightening trip as well. And this understanding of history will serve us when we're trying to filter the fuckery of the history that we're being told by certain groups of people. And trust me, these people will start implicating themselves. So I think the best thing to do here is just to give you a general understanding of what the Crusades were in case you don't know. And we'll just, like I said, we're going to go to Charlatan's Web. The Crusades were a series of religious wars initiated, supported, and sometimes directed by the Latin Church in the medieval period. The best known of these Crusades are those to the Holy Land. The best known of these Crusades are those to the Holy Land in the period between 1095 and 1291 that are intended to recover Jerusalem and its surrounding area from Islamic rule. Beginning with the First Crusade, which resulted in the recovery of Jerusalem in 1099, dozens of crusades were fought, providing a focal point of European history for centuries. A focal point of European history for centuries. Damn, they spitting out here. I mean, it was a half bar. In modern historiography, the term crusade first referred to military expeditions undertaken by European Christians in the 11th, 12th, and 13th centuries to the Holy Land. Interesting. The conflicts to which the term is applied has been extended to include other campaigns initiated, supported, and sometimes directed by the Roman Catholic Church against pagans and heretics for alleged religious ends. These differed from other Christian religious wars in that they were considered a penitential exercise and so earned participants forgiveness for all confessed sins. Hey, yo, I need you to kill them niggas and you are forgiven, my child. Go get them. At the time of the First Crusade, Iter, Journey, and Peregrinatio, pilgrimage were used for the first campaign. Guess that's how you say that shit. Crusader terminology remained largely indistinguishable from that of Christian pilgrimage during the 12th century. A specific term for a crusader in the form of crucis signatus, one signed by the cross, however, emerged in the 12th century. This led to the French croisade. Croissant, nigga? The way of the cross. By the mid-13th century, the cross became the major descriptor of the Crusades, with the Cruz Transmarina, the cross overseas, used for the Crusades in the Eastern Mediterranean. The cross overseas. By overseas, they mean across the Mediterranean, the seas of the Mediterranean. Yeah. The Cruz Cismarina, the cross this side of the sea, for those in Europe. The use of the Crusaderie, Crusades, in Middle English can be dated to 1300, but the Middle English Crusade dates to the early 1700s. All right. Probably shouldn't even read that. There's nothing about this here. Nothing to see here. So basically, to cut through all the BS, the Catholic Church initiated these crusades within the Holy Land from the 11th through the 13th century. Keep that in mind, all right? The Crusader invasions of Egypt, 1163 to 1169, were a series of campaigns undertaken by the Kingdom of Jerusalem to strengthen its position in the Levant by taking advantage of the weakness of Fatimid Egypt. Who is the Kingdom of Jerusalem? Kingdom of Jerusalem, officially known as the Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem, also known as the Frankish Kingdom of Jerusalem, also known as the Frankish Kingdom of Jerusalem, was a crusader state that was established in the Levant immediately after the First Crusade. It lasted for almost 200 years, from the ascension of Godfrey of Bouillon in 1099 until the siege of Acre in 1291. Its history divided into two periods with a brief interruption in its existence. A little interruption. Beginning with its collapse after the siege of Jerusalem in 1187 and its restoration after the Third Crusade. Oh, so they invaded Jerusalem. You know, that area over there that they're calling Jerusalem. Right, they invaded that. The vast majority of the Crusaders who established and settled the Kingdom of Jerusalem were from the Kingdom of France, as were the knights and soldiers who made up the bulk of the steady flow of reinforcements throughout the 200-year span of its existence. Its rulers and elite were therefore predominantly French. French crusaders also brought their language to the Levant, thus establishing Old French as the lingua franca of the crusader states, in which Latin served as the official language, while the majority of the population in the countryside comprised of Christians and Muslims from local Levantine ethnicities. Many Europeans, primarily French and Italian, arrived to settle in villages across the region.
It's a crusader state
funded by the French, right? The Frankish Kingdom of Jerusalem, the French. It's a military crusader state funded by the French. Also, Catholic Church. Under the auspices of what? To spread some sort of religious propaganda? With the cruz, if you will, or cross? Similar to the whole funding of, you know, of that place that doesn't even exist in history yet, you know? Right? That place is, no, it's not in history yet, all right? It doesn't even, where is it? No one's been cross seas. No, that doesn't mean across an actual sea, okay? Means, you know what it means. Don't be a smart ass. Here's the thing about the Crusades, there's a lot of them, quite a few. They take place in the Holy Land for centuries in the Holy Land. You know, did you know that? Bet you didn't know that. You know, bro, should have worked it in early. I think it's too late, but you know, did it anyway, throw it in there.
Question number one. How did the Egyptians move 20 to 50 ton granite slabs from the Aswan quarry 500 miles upriver to Giza? To let the Egyptologists tell you, these multi-ton slabs were moved by men with ropes and possibly oxen from the quarry to the river, mind you, without the invention of the wheel. According to the top side theories, wooden planks were placed horizontally under the rocks and were pulled over sand by hand, by man. Apparently using water as a KY jelly, if you will, to lessen that desert friction and let those rocks slide down by the river with ease into one of those tight little Egyptian boats. This theory, along with the associated side theories, presents us with 99 problems, other than the bitch of transporting anything weighing in excess of 2 tons through the desert or over any land in general without the use of the wheel. A feat humans still haven't effectively accomplished unto this day. Even the train has wheels. But the bitch of unloading the 20-ton Aswan granite onto a vessel and then shipping it to Giza 500 miles away to then upload it and again transport it over more land and then elevate it hundreds of feet in the air is a whole gang of bitches in a Nissan Altima. The driving the Altima is the main character. How the fuck she pulling 12 fuel tankers and an entire forest, Final Destination style, in a Nissan Altima with no wheels? Comparatively, how do you ship a mountain of granite on a boat with the capacity of 6 fat bitches? No matter how you arrange them, strap one to the roof, tie one in the trunk. You can only fit 6 of them in there or on there, because as soon as you add an extra one, what happens? The Altima bottoms out and it capsizes. Basically the same with Egyptian boats.
That's science right there, nigga.
Khufu is the pharaoh that scholars say is responsible for the construction of the Great Pyramid. However, the techniques used to build the Great Pyramid are found nowhere on record. The Khufu ship is the largest representation of an ancient vessel on record. This ship couldn't effectively transport 5 tons, much less 10, 20, 30, or even 50 tons. So if this specialized pyramid granite is indeed from Aswan, How did they transport it on the Nile? By using the vessels they describe. As immaculate as some of these Egyptian records seem to be, surprisingly, there is no record of any 50-ton shipping vessel found throughout the infinite yet limited archives documenting such a vessel. If such a record does exist, it is no doubt hidden within the slave ships.
Or with the technology we need to go back to the moon.
This nigga here, boy.
Now let's just say you ride with the boat story. There is still the bitch of elevating multi-ton granite into perfect position. And this is where the ramp theory comes in. In this theory, the Egyptians slid heavy stones up a ramp using ropes, because according to their historical handbook, pulleys or cranes had not been invented yet. Although their father of Greek history, Herodotus, says otherwise, but never mentions ramps.
I don't know who to believe, man.
Be all this as it may, ramp theories abound among the upper echelons of Egypt charlatanology.
To build things so accurately such a long time ago is, I mean, frankly amazing.
They work and speak. Egyptologists think the pyramid only took 20 years to build.
Never trust a nigga with a bolo hat. You don't know what he had to do to earn those stripes.
Now, if you think floating a mountain of granite down the river or up the river is a bitch, then imagine pulling that mountain of granite up a hill of stone at over a 10% gradient slope using a rope. You must think I'm smoking.
Are you good with numbers?
Yeah,
right. How much is 4,343?
Now, I'm no Rain Man, but I know a little math. At 100 pounds per man, it would take 20 men per ton to move a block evenly distributed.
Times 1,234.
But even that assumption is physically impossible considering the details. How many men could even move that 100 pounds per man with a rope up a slope? You would need hundreds to thousands of men to move even a single block using the methods described. Men with some otherworldly balance and strength beyond the NFL, even if they had the retro 2-inch copper spiked sand nigga 3s on, this feat of strength requires more than a pole and the airing of grievances to manage. So even if they did create a ramp with a minimal 33 spiral slope a mile long, it would still need to be wide enough for 1,000 men to each have their turn hitting the pipe. This leads us to the question of rocks. How did they cut them bitches with such precision? And we are back with another hit from Charlatan's Web, The Diary of Merer, or Merer. So whenever they need to try to prove something in history, they always seem to make a perfect discovery to fit their narrative. Similar to what happened with the Dead Sea Scrolls. And the first time I came across Harry Hubbard, he was debunking the Dead Sea Scrolls and showing how they were actually counterfeit.
It is not a good thing to discover or find or try to propagate ancient Mediterranean tombs in North America.
No, it's not.
Yeah. Okay, if you're trying to change the history of North America, you have no friends.
Yeah.
If you're trying to change the history of the world, everyone hates you.
So I just find it interesting that whenever they need something, all of a sudden the perfect piece of evidence shows up. And this evidence is the Diary of Merer. The Diary of Merer is the name for papyrus logbooks written over 4,500 years ago by Merer, a middle-ranking official with the title Inspector. They are the oldest known papyri with text dating to the 27th year of the reign of Pharaoh Khufu during the 4th dynasty. The text, written with hieroglyphics, mostly consists of the daily activities of Merer and his crew. The most well-preserved sections document the transportation of white limestone blocks from the Tura quarries to Giza by boat. Buried in front of man-made caves that served to store the boats at Wadi al-Jarf on the Red Sea, the papyri were found and excavated in 2013 by a French mission under the direction of archaeologists Pierre Tallet of Paris-Sorbonne University and Gregory Marard. The Egyptian archaeologist Zahai Hawass describes the diary of Merer as the greatest discovery in Egypt in the 21st century. Parts of the papyri are exhibited at the Egyptian Museum in Cairo. Wow, what a find. That is amazing that they found a logbook that stated, hey man, we're taking these limestone blocks from Tura to Giza by boat. So, you know, all of our theories, they were true. Obviously, check out this diary here. End quote. Charlatan's Web. Of all the mysteries surrounding the construction of ancient Egypt, the Egyptians' ability to cut stone and sculpt images with such perfection and symmetry out of extremely hard surfaces has baffled historians and birthed an entire Nissan Altima full of bitches to deal with. The top experts all say the Egyptians were able to cut limestone, which is somewhat forgiving, but also cut granite,
which is an extremely hard surface.
How are they able to achieve symmetrical perfection by hand? Some of the most elaborate and complex shapes are said to be chiseled into granite without the help of any machinery. Grounded narrow incisions deep within the rock are assumed to have been made with these same primitive instruments. How can someone do this with this? That's like doing this with this. Or this with this. Shit. Maybe even this with this. These so-called experts have gone to extremely hilarious lengths to prove these theories, often demonstrating techniques used to achieve these feats without ever actually completing the task to fruition.
The ancient mason would use the rods and string to spot imperfections.
These exhibitions are often short, incomplete, or altogether manufactured composite digital graphics of a fabricated hypothesis.
Lehner and almost all Egyptologists believe that some kind of ramp was used to raise the stone blocks.
Unto this day, no one has authentically replicated any Egyptian monument or statue using these assumed methods.
To reduce all mystery in the world to nothing, they just can't do it with the Great Pyramid.
One of the more convincing theories was proposed by French scientist Joseph Davidovits, who attested that the limestone blocks were not rocks or carved stone, but instead a limestone geopolymer concrete that was molded and cast on site. As opposed to multi-ton rocks being cut from the quarry and transported over land to the pyramids, he proposes that a clay mixture using lime and natron would create a paste that would dry in the sun and create hardened limestone, therefore eliminating the need to cut and transport multi-ton limestone blocks. They could, in his theory, be easily made on site. Perhaps the most compelling aspect of Davidovits' theory isn't the overall practicality, logic, or reason. It is the simple fact that his concrete theory has been completely shut down by mainstream archaeology and Egyptology. Of course, this only makes his case more compelling to the skeptics of accepted academic dogma. With the help of colleague Michelle Barsoom, materials science researcher at Drexel University, they published a paper in the Journal of the American Ceramic Society titled "Microstructural Evidence of Reconstituted Limestone Blocks in the Great Pyramids of Egypt." In the study, it was found that pockets of air were discovered within the Great Pyramid stones, indicating that they were not natural stone, but instead agglomerated stone.
According to Encyclopedia Britannica, the most plausible one is that the Egyptians employed a sloping and encircling embankment of brick, earth, and sand, which was increased in height and length as the pyramid rose. Stone blocks were hauled up the ramp by means of sledges, rollers, and levers.
Barsoom and Davidovits were not in complete agreement, however. Barsoom found that the mixture wasn't clay, but diatomaceous earth. Otherwise, fossil remains. He also believes that only the higher portions of the pyramid were man-made blocks, and that the lower portions were still cut stone. MIT professor Lynn Hobbs considers himself agnostic on Davidovits' geopolymer theory. He is not a proponent nor opponent. His class researched the possibility of Egyptians making their own concrete by using different materials available to the Egyptians at the time and various chemical formulas, and concludes that the Egyptians had everything they needed to build the pyramids using Davidovits' theory, and furthermore holds that his theory should not be dismissed and taken seriously academically. Yet Hobbs did not wholeheartedly adopt Davidovits' concrete theory. In his opinion, they probably did both, cut some and cast some. Whether he truly believes this or not is of no consequence. Just like Barsoom, riding the fence is job security. I mean, he works for MIT, but his willingness to admit that stones were actually cast stands in direct opposition to the official historical academic narrative, but going too far left would be career suicide. But even beyond the limestone, whether it was cut or cast, it doesn't answer the question about the granite. Those limestone blocks aren't as nearly as hard to fashion as granite, a much harder stone. And there are plenty of examples of granite being fashioned into perfection in contrast to the limestone, which honestly is really weird considering limestone is much easier to cut. But the granite is cut to perfection, and the limestone is cut with no observable uniformity.
What is the problem here? The problem is that we are dealing with a material that is an aggregation of fossil shells. You see here the shells that are constituting the pyramid blocks. We have 95% of shells, and in between a very tiny amount of the binder that is called micritic binder.
In a 2019 documentary, director Fahimi Krasniqi presents a mind-blowing revelation about Egyptians and their granite monuments. He contends that the Egyptians made their own granite. Yes, you heard that right. He asserts that the Egyptians used large glass lenses to direct sunlight onto granite rocks. The heat reaches a temperature of over 3,500 degrees, causing the granite to change properties and liquefy. The hot granite is then poured into a clay mold and hardens over a short period of time. The result is a perfectly manicured image of the mold. However fantastic this theory may be, there is no evidence that the Egyptians used solar lenses to melt stone, along with any evidence that Egyptians actually built the pyramids. Never mind. There are numerous examples of Egyptians fashioning even harder stone than granite, like graywack, migmatite, and pyrite, all of which the documentary claims was made in a similar fashion to the granite pieces. The accredited Egyptologist has no explanation for how these were made and doesn't seem too concerned with providing one. Since this documentary, numerous questions have been asked regarding the natural legitimacy of the granite used in ancient Egypt. The main question being, did the Egyptians make their own artificial granite? Today, the production of artificial granite is no longer a mystery, but recipes to the rock may vary. The charlatan cynics point to the lack of observable fracturing in the stones used to make these granite statues. They argue that the consistency of texture exhibited in these crafted granite statues and objects does not exist anywhere in nature. Additionally, skeptics argue that chiseling with copper instruments would only cause more fracturing in this supposedly natural rock. What we haven't touched on so far are the Americas and the obvious stone manipulation in the unmentioned civilizations that could possibly even predate ancient Egypt. No matter if you believe these stones were cut or cast, certainly the same thing wasn't happening in the Americas even before the Egyptians. Or was it? Never mind. Never mind.
And we're back with some history. And we're back with some history, yeah.
Quote, Charlatan's Web. The focus of the Crusaders shifted decisively towards Egypt, and less so towards the Levant. This could be seen in the Third Crusade, where Richard the Lionheart recognized the importance of Egypt and twice suggested an invasion of the region. An assault against the Levant could not succeed without the resources and manpower of Egypt, which currently gave the Islamic powers in the region a decisive advantage. The 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 9th, and Alexandrian Crusades all had Egypt as the intended target. What? During the Fifth Crusade, 1218 to 1221, a large force of crusaders led by Pelagio Galvani and John of Brienne took Damietta. The expeditionary force included French, German, Flemish, and Austrian crusaders in a Frisian fleet. The army marched on Cairo but was cut off by the flooding of the Nile, and the campaign ended in disaster with Pelagio forced to surrender with what remained of his army. Okay. During the Seventh Crusade, King Louis IX of France invaded Egypt in 1249. After occupying Damietta, he marched towards Cairo. However, the forces led by Robert I, Count of Artois, no Stella, were defeated at the Battle of Al-Mansura. And then King Louis and his main army were defeated at the Battle of Ferisker. The king suffered the humiliation of having to pay an enormous ransom for his freedom. By 1291, Acre, the last major crusader fortress in the Holy Land, fell to the forces of Mamluk, Sultan of Egypt, and any remaining territories on the mainland were lost over the next decade. Interesting. They just like that. Just like that. Just on some Kaiser Soze shit. They were gone. We're done with this crusader thing. This whole Templar thing. We're done, man. So they took a L. Looked like they took a couple L's in Egypt, bruh. Looked like they took a couple L's in Egypt. And when they won, that was like, fuck it, we out. We're not gonna win. We're just gonna come back with Napoleon. Whoa, wait till Napoleon shows up. Like 500 years later, Napoleon's coming for all your stuff. And we're gonna be rough. We've had enough. Napoleon is coming for all your stuff. And we're gonna be tough. Egypt, we had enough. Napoleon's coming for your stuff in the year 17 something. But when we get your shit, we're gonna know about the pyramids. Cause for some reason, we ain't figured them bitches out yet. Nor does history even talk about them shit. I haven't seen one mention of the pyramids. I did see a quote, but didn't say much. Where is that quote? Somebody hid behind the pyramids. It's like, yeah, the pyramids of Giza. There was a mention of the pyramids of Giza in this little bullshit, Roger. They camped at Giza, okay? They said here. Let's see. Here we go. Afterwards, the Crusaders started to build a bridge over the Nile. So the Crusaders built a bridge over the Nile in March 1167. But the Syrian archers prevent the end of the work. However, Shere Khan's army remained garrisoned outside the pyramids of Giza because leaving the place would allow the Crusaders to cross the Nile. And see, this is where, and this is what we're talking about now. This is exactly what we're talking about. Where's this quote come from? This quote is, you see all this shit and how they talk and what they talking about. Look at that. Look at that shit right there. Crusade, 1935. Talking about some bitch hid behind the pyramids. Where you hear that shit, boy? You ain't hear that shit, boy. Crusade. That's that shit now. So that's what I was talking about. I knew there was a pyramid quote in there. Yeah. It was written in 1935. Yeah. All right, now. So, saying all that, say this. French now. Now, them Frenches is something different. I'm going to tell you something. Because what they're really telling you is, these family, bitch, they blood, bro. You see what I'm saying? You see what I'm saying, though? You see what I'm saying, though? All right. You see what I'm saying, though.
Sobrevivo sin saber si voy. Sobrevivo sin saber si voy. Sobrevivo sin saber si voy. Sobrevivo sin dónde estoy.
What's really going on here? How was it that France, secretly known as the Kingdom of Jerusalem, invaded Egypt during the 12th century with several campaigns, but they literally had zero knowledge of the pyramids or Egyptian history, even though they had been there centuries before the Napoleonic invasion? How is this possible? The same families that funded colonialism in America were the same families who financed the Crusades in Egypt. So why didn't they know anything about Egyptian history? If France truly invaded Egypt in 1798 with Napoleon and conquered the land, why aren't there any major Egyptian cities named after French kings or the French in general? King Louis IX faced his humiliating defeat during the Crusades in Egypt. But when the French returned to Egypt centuries later to conquer, instead of naming any Egyptian city after any French people or King Louis, they instead decide to name another city on another continent after their fallen king. In fact, they named multiple cities after their fallen king. But surprisingly, none in Egypt. What would be the logic in that? Speaking of logic, what is the most logical explanation for why they knew absolutely nothing about the pyramids until after 1800? And does that logic add up to their recorded and accepted history? Does that logic answer the question, who built the pyramids? We are told they were tombs for the pharaohs, but not one pharaoh's mummified corpse has been found inside the Great Pyramid.
Where is the pyramid in the picture of Napoleon and the Sphinx? Where is the pyramid in the picture? They should be behind this, you know, the Sphinx there, but this picture is wrong. But you know, there's a lot of wrong pictures in this.
Additionally, we are told the reason for the absence of the bodies is the fact that all the tombs have been completely robbed of not just the riches, but the bodies too. This aspect should at least narrow the list of suspects, because there's definitely a prototype of the kind of motherfucker who would even have the nerve to rob a tomb. This person has a specific profile. One of the things I found most interesting was the clear inferiority of medieval art when compared to ancient Egyptian sculpture. These contemporary Europeans couldn't even sketch as well as the Egyptians could sculpt. And the ancient Egyptians apparently could sculpt so well that their imprints didn't age. Only the structures around them. I mean, it's not like someone came in and started chiseling new symbology onto old monuments. The Egyptians were superior, even to nature. How else could they have done anything, we are being told, if they weren't? On the next episode of America is Egypt, we highlight the Freemasons and their connection to the construction of every building of significance in the world. On the next episode of America is Egypt.
Sheeeiiiiit.
Untold, copyright unsold, books with one spine, ghosts with one soul. They want control, you want control, but we share one goal, we fight one foe, satchel front door, and it keeps knocking, but the people kept rocking, yeah. And it keeps knocking, but the people kept rocking, yeah. Stop, flex, whatever they do, they can't stop.
This nigga cutting hair like a lost Egyptian, bro. Put this nigga on the assignment. Oh, on second thought, maybe.
Sheeeiiiit.